Which of these bifurcations is robust under perturbation? Meaning if the mathematical structure changed a little bit, what would happen? So we'll look at them in turn. First, we'll look at the saddle node, and then we'll look at transcritical and then pitchfork. The saddle node, it's sufficient to just perturb the normal form. So if the normal form looked like that, then we could perturb this. So we want to add the lowest order term that would perturb it and see what happens. There's already a zeroth order term, that's R. So perturbing that wouldn't make any sense. There's no linear term. So add a linear term that's got another parameter. So the linear term will be epsilon x. If we perturb this, we've got x dot equals r plus epsilon x minus x squared. For epsilon not equal to zero, we have fixed points. So just set x dot equal to zero and solve. So quadratic equation, fixed points at x star equals epsilon over 2, 1 plus or minus square root 1 minus 4r over epsilon squared. So we have fixed points there, and we could look at their stability, df dx at x star. Remember, this, the sign of this gives us the stability. It ends up being epsilon minus 2x star. We could plot different cases. We'll plot first epsilon greater than 0. And it just sort of moves where our, I won't be careful about which one's positive, which one's negative. It just moves where the saddle node happens. It doesn't happen at 0 anymore. It happens a little bit off of 0. What am I plotting here? X star versus R. About epsilon equals 0. Well, epsilon equals 0 is the one we've already seen. Epsilon less than 0. Instead of the parabola being above the R axis, it'll be below the R axis. The saddle node bifurcation survives. It just moves a little. You might say, well, why didn't we go from R to R plus something? Because that would just basically be shifting where that happens. So we could say, so the saddle node bifurcation, another way to say if, you know, if something survives is we could say it is robust. All right. So what about the transcritical? Let's look at the transcritical normal form. The normal form there was x dot equals rx minus x squared. We wouldn't add on a linear term. We would add on a constant term. The lowest order term to perturb this is a constant term. And again, we'll call that epsilon. So we'll just add in plus epsilon. And I'll just summarize what happens. First, we'll do epsilon equals 0. We know what happens for epsilon equals 0. X equals 0 goes unstable, and then x equals r goes from unstable to stable. X star versus r. What happens when epsilon is less than 0? What we get is that this stable branch just sort of misses, and the unstable branch just sort of misses. So if you were to be zooming out, it looks still like a transcritical, but the two points don't actually intersect. They don't exchange. You have that one stable point stays stable and moves. The other is unstable and moves. And again, this would be, you know, x star over here, r, stable, unstable. In some sense, there really isn't a bifurcation. The transcritical bifurcation does not seem to survive a constant term when the constant term is negative. What about this other case when epsilon is greater than 0? What happens? Far away, it looks the same. Unstable and stable. And the same thing over here. Unstable, stable. But all of the action happens in the middle. So what happens for this case? For this case, you actually have two saddle node bifurcations. And then in the middle, there's no fixed point at all. I guess we still have a bifurcation in this case. We have two saddle node bifurcations. So over here, there was no bifurcation. Over here, we had two saddle node bifurcations. So it's looking like the transcritical bifurcation is not robust. If you breathe on this the wrong way, it disappears. What's the opposite of robust? I guess we could say fragile or just not robust. Although it's still a useful paradigm, right? If you zoom out, you still, okay, it looks like there was an equilibrium point that exchanged stability. If I don't look really close at the details in the middle. And it's looking like saddle node bifurcation. It's confirmed that it's robust, because if it shows up when other things fail, that means something. If you want, we could even put in the, what do the arrows look like? These different cases. In between the two, there's no equilibrium point, so things just sort of go on through. And then we have this case. All right, that was the second out of the three. What about the last one? Well, the pitchfork bifurcation, the normal form looks a lot like the transcritical. Pitchfork bifurcation. The normal form, like we wrote, x dot equals rx minus x cubed. And again, the lowest order term to perturb this would be a constant term, just like before, add a constant term, and then see what happens. We know what happens for, I'll just show, for epsilon equals zero, we know what happens here. We've got stable, goes unstable, and then two branches of stable points. What about an epsilon is not zero? Here's what you'll get. For far away, we still have just one stable point. And afterwards, we have stable and unstable and stable. But what about the details of what happened in between? Here's what happens. This just becomes, it just connects. So we have one stable point that just moves, and the other two came out of a saddle node bifurcation. So again, the saddle node bifurcation just sort of emerges as the robust saddle node bifurcation. What am I plotting here? Where's the equilibrium point or fixed point as a function of the parameter? Pitchfork bifurcation is not robust. Why didn't I add delta x squared? I don't have to. It's already not robust when I add the lowest order term. It's not going to get any better. I don't know, maybe other things could happen if I added a quadratic term, but pitchfork bifurcation is not robust. Philosophically, why is the saddle node robust? I don't know. They are known to be robust, and they're seen in experiments, whereas you really have to like set up your experiment very carefully to see a transcritical or pitchfork, and you probably aren't really seeing it. It's kind of like if you're avoiding actually looking in that region where everything really happens, just avoiding it. So if you kind of squint and look at the big picture, you go, oh yeah, it looks kind of like a pitchfork, but probably what's really happening is a bunch of saddle nodes and a bunch of equilibrium points just moving out of the way. We're looking at these bifurcations in one dimension, and you might say, well, I want to study something that's 100 dimensions, so who cares? You can still get these in higher dimensional systems. They'll be the most prominent things that happen in higher dimensional systems, because there'll always be some direction that we call like the center manifold direction along which the dynamics can show bifurcations. I'm going to show you what does the saddle node bifurcation in 2D look like, just so you have an idea. Saddle node bifurcation in 2D, analytical version. X dot equals P x squared plus 1. Y dot equals negative lambda y. So this is of that form that I showed the first time, where it's like x1 dot equals f of x1, x2, x2 dot equals, or I guess it'd be f1, f2, x1, x2. And here I've called x1 x and x2 equal to y. So it's in that form. This second ODE is easier to solve, because we know y as a function of time is going to be e to the negative lambda t times y naught. The things will just be decreasing if you were to plot what the phase portrait looks like. So now I'm plotting x and y and just plotting what trajectories will do. We're looking at lambda is greater than zero. For lambda greater than zero, that means y is always decreasing towards the x-axis. If I show p greater than zero, then what will trajectories look like? They'll be kind of going this way. So things are decreasing towards the x-axis, but then in x, they're just sort of going off. If I change p to less than zero, then this picture will qualitatively change. Right here, there's no fixed points. The end state is that things go to the x-axis and then go to infinity, positive infinity. when P is less than zero, you'll still have sort of by continuity far away on the x-axis, things are kind of moving to the right. And also negative x-axis, things are moving to the right. So it's going to be the same thing here. But in the middle, we'll have that there's an unstable point, and over here, a stable point. And this stable point over here will have trajectories leaving it along the x-axis. And along some other direction, trajectories will be approaching it. This is called a saddle, this structure where you've got a direction where things are approaching and then a direction where things are leaving, because it's kind of like what would happen if you have a marble on a horse's saddle. There's directions where the marble will approach and then it would kind of fall off. So we have a saddle, and that's where this gets its name for saddle. So you can guess the other point will be called a node. So this is a saddle fixed point, and nearby trajectories will just sort of follow what you would expect for my saddle. And this other thing is called a node. A node is a fixed point where everything's just sort of coming in on straight lines. They're not, there's no swirling, technical term. Locally, things just look like they're approaching this. We'll get into more detail, like, well, how do you know what's a node? But so this stable point is called a node. You could also have unstable nodes. The saddle is considered an unstable point, even though there is a direction in which things are approaching, because any small displacement away will generally move away. So that's where you get the name saddle node from what things look like in a 2D system. You could have saddle node bifurcations happening in higher dimensional systems. So here, I guess we could say up here, we said there were no fixed points. Here, there are two fixed points.